Hello everyone, welcome to Mechanical Sathi. So in this video we are going to discuss another set of 10 questions. So already we have discussed 30 questions and 30 MCQs basically. So in the series of bijextal MCQs. So in this video we will discuss from the question number 31 to question number 40. So without wasting time, let us move forward and start our discussion. So question number 31. So simply it is telling that for a simple closed system, for a constant composition, the difference between the net heat and work interaction is identifiable as the change in what? Options are given like enthalpy, entropy, flow energy and internal energy. So if we'll see, according to the first law of thermodynamics, if there is a state change, then we can say if any state is going from the state 1 to state 2, then we can write this equation, that is the first law of thermodynamics. Already we know. If we don't know, so you can know from this. So if, so let me draw any PV diagram, okay. So PV diagram for the system, then I can draw like this. So let us draw any points. So let this point is state point 1 and this point is state point 2. So this is the initial point and this is the final point, and these are the two state points for any process. And if it is going through this path, let this is the quasi-static path, okay. So we can say during this path it may do some interaction, that energy interactions in the form of work or the in the form of heat. Then the difference in between heat and that heat interaction and work interaction, we know that is that will give a property difference, or that property, that what is that property basically we have to answer here. So from the first law of thermodynamics we know that dq will be equal to d u plus d w, okay. So in this statement, in this equation, we can say this is the difference, okay. So that you can write, if we'll be taking this term to this side, then you can write dq minus dw, okay, that will be equal to du, and this du is what, this is nothing but this is the internal energy of that system, okay. So that change in internal energy during the state change from state 1 to state 2, that is the internal energy, that is du basically. So for this question we can write as our answer is the option number 4, okay. So for 31, your option number 4 will be the correct answer. Moving next, that is question number 32. So let us read it. So Joule Thomson coefficient is the slope of which diagram basically it is asking about. So option number 1, it is telling that constant enthalpy lines on TS diagram. Option 2, that constant enthalpy lines on TP diagram. And option 3, it is telling that inversion curves on the TS diagram, and option 4 is telling that inversion curve on the TP diagram. So Joule Thomson coefficient basically shown in the TP diagram, okay. So let me draw the TP diagram over here. So let us erase it, okay. So in, if we'll be plotting any graph in case in between UT and P. Okay, temperature is taken in the y-axis and the pressure is taken in the x-axis. Then we'll be getting the constant enthalpy lines somewhat like this. Okay, so we'll be getting the constant enthalpy lines in this way. And Joule-Thomson coefficient, that is basically denoted by mu. And mu will be equal to what? That will be equal to del T by del P at constant enthalpy, that is H. Okay, so for this question, your option number 2 will be the correct answer, that is the constant enthalpy lines on the TP diagram. Okay, and if we'll be taking here somewhat our mu will be equal to 0. So mu will be equal to 0 at in this line, and before that line we'll be having with positive value of mu, and after that we'll be getting a negative value of mu. Okay, so nothing to worry about this negative, positive, all these things. So simply we can say from this from this diagram that the Joule-Thomson coefficient is the slope of constant enthalpy lines on the TP diagram. So option number 2 will be the correct answer for this question. So moving next towards the question number 33. So here it is telling that work done in a reversible adiabatic process from state 1 to state 2 is given by. So I think you must have remember this relation for adiabatic process, and that is the work done for reversible adiabatic process, that is otherwise known as the isentropic process. So for that I think you remember that relation is your P2V2 minus P1V1 divided by 1 minus gamma. Okay, so this is the relation which we can also derive. So let me give the some hint how can we derive this relation. So okay, so we know the relation for reversible adiabatic is that PV to the power gamma is equal to constant, and for a closed system when we have to find out the work done, that we can calculate by integrating from 1 to 2 PdV. Okay, so for a closed system, and okay, so for reversible adiabatic we can simply write the integration over PdV. Okay, integration of PdV over 1 to 2 will give us the work done. Okay, so from this relation we can put this value of P over here, that will be equal to C, some constant, divided by V to the power gamma. So if we write that, then I can write dV by V to the power gamma from 1 to 2. Okay, so if we'll be integrating that, we'll be getting some terms over here, and that term will also will give us the value of our work done for the reversible adiabatic process. Okay, so this is how we can derive the relation. And if you have remembered this relation, then there is nothing to worry about, and you can simply tick on the option number 4 as the right answer for this question. So for question number 33, option number 4 will be the correct answer. Moving next towards question number 34. So which of the following expressions gives the entropy change in an isobaric heating process from T1 to T2? Okay, so T1, so there is a state change. Again we can say state 1 is having with a property, that is temperature is T1, and at the state 2 again another property that is your temperature, that is T2. Okay, so we need to find out, or we need to check the expression for entropy sense. Okay, so process is given as isobaric heating process, and for this process we have to find out or we have to check the expression. Okay, so options are given like this: mcp ln T2 by T1, mcp T2 minus T1, and option 3 is that mcp T2 minus T1 divided by T0, and option 4 is telling that mcp T2 plus T1, okay, which is multiplied. So let us try to check what our answer will be. Okay, so simply in the second law of thermodynamics, your cp, sorry, that is the change of entropy, and it is will be equal to what? So we can write ds will be equal to dq by t. Okay, so dq by t essentially will be equal to change in entropy for a reversible process, and as it is telling that isobaric heating process, we can assume that it is a reversible process. Okay, so let us try to find out the value or the term dq by t. So where d obviously it is not the exact differential, so that's we can show by crossing a line over here. Okay, so if I will be writing simply dq, then I can write mcp, okay, cp T2 minus T1. Okay, so let this is not dq, that is only q. Okay, so heat interaction we can find out by this formula, that is mcp into the change in temperature. Okay, so for a small interval or for a small dq, if I will be trying to find out, so let us differentiate it. Okay, so dq I can write like mcp dt. okay, so for a small temperature change, so whatever temperature change will be that we can put over here. So for a small temperature change, what will be the heat interaction, that we can find out from here. So now if I'll be dividing t, okay, in both the sides, so that I can write here t and here also t. okay, so after getting this, if I'll be integrating, okay, so I can simply dq by t replace this by ds. okay, so dq by t for a reversible process I can replace by ds. After that, if I will integrate from 1 to 2, that is step point 1 to step point 2 in both the sides, so I can write like this. So ds integration I can write s2 minus s1. okay, that we need to calculate, or that expression we need to find out. And here m and cp, that mass of this substance or the system, whatever working fluid or working medium inside that system, that will be constant. And cp obviously that specific heat of that matter which is inside that system, that will be also constant. So if we integrate dt by t from 1 to 2, then we'll be getting as ln t. okay, so from 1 to 2, so I can write ln t2 minus ln t1. okay, so this term I can replace by ln t2 by ln t1, so and that will be multiplied with constant term whatever will be there, that is mcp. So from here we can get our answer as mcp ln t2 divided by ln t1. okay, so that is ln t2 by t1 directly. So we can check our option 1 will be the correct answer for this question. Okay, so for question number 34, option number 1 will be the correct answer. So let us move towards next question, that is question number 35. the main cause of irreversibility is what? Okay, so options are given like mechanical and fluid friction. So obviously this is one of the reason, and this is one of the important reason. Okay, unrestricted expansion, obviously again this is also the correct answer. So let us check option number 3 also. So heat transfer with a finite temperature difference. Okay, so this is also a cause of an irreversibility. So we can check as check our option number 4 as the correct answer, and option number 4 will be the correct answer for this question. Okay, so all these three options which are given over here are the correct answer, are the main causes for the irreversibility. Okay, so option number 4 will be the correct answer. So next, question number 36 is asking to find out the efficiency of the engine. Okay, so let us read it. Engine so work on the Carnot cycle between temperature range is given as 727 degree to 227 degree centigrade, and we need to find out the efficiency of engine. Okay, of that engine. So simply we know the Carnot relation, Carnot efficiency. So if this is the Carnot cycle, let me draw the temperature versus entropy diagram for the Carnot cycle, and this is the two constant entropy process, these are the two constant temperature processes, and these are two constant at constant entropy process, or we can say simple reversible adiabatic processes. So let this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and this cycle is moving like this. Okay, so this temperature is given as 727 and in terms of degree centigrade, and this temperature is given as 227 degree centigrade. Okay, so let us try to convert into absolute scale first. So absolute temperature we can write 727 plus 2733 approximately, so we can now find as 1000 Kelvin. Okay, so T higher temperature we can calculate as 1000 Kelvin. Okay, so this is K. Okay, sorry, so this is 1000 Kelvin, and your lower temperature, so I can write it as TL. So TL is given as 227 plus 273, so I think this is will be your 500 Kelvin. Okay, so efficiency of that engine we can calculate like this. There is minus, so let me erase it. Okay, so 1 minus T lower minus T higher. Okay, so that will be equal to what? 1 minus TL is given as 500 and T higher is given as 1000. So we will be getting 0.5 over here, and this is 1. So 1 minus 0.5 obviously we will be getting as 0.5. So 0.5, that is your 50%. So obviously the efficiency for this Carnot cycle will be the 50%. So option number 1 will be the correct answer for this question, that is question number 36. So let us move towards next question, that is question number 37. So let us read it. So in the Van der Waals equation, which is given below, that is P plus A by B square whole into B minus B is equal to RT. So the term A by B square represents what? Okay, options are given like pressure, force of adhesion and force of cohesion, or none of these. Okay, so if you read it in detail about the Van der Waals equation, Van der Waals gas equation, then you must know that A by B square is giving the force of cohesion in between the molecules. present in that system. Okay, so A by B square represents the force of cohesion, so option 3 will be the correct answer. And if we'll be telling about the term B, then this is giving the mass of the molecule which is present. Okay, mass of one molecule basically, sorry, volume of that one molecule in which is present in that system. So B is giving idea about the volume, and A by B square is telling about the force of cohesion. Okay, so for this question, that is question number 37, option 3 will be the correct answer. So now let us moving towards next question, that is question number 38. So let us read. Extensive property of a system is one whose value. Okay, so obviously we know from the theory of basic thermodynamics that extensive property are those properties which are dependent on the mass. Okay, so if the properties are depending on the mass, that means if mass of any system changes, obviously the properties is going to change, then those type of properties are known as the extensive properties. And the opposite to extensive, we can say intensive property. And those properties which are independent on mass can be called as the intensive properties. So basically we know that what an extensive property is. So let us read all those options so that we can get our correct answer. So depends, first option telling that depends on the mass of the system, like volume. So obviously this is the correct option, we can say, but let us read all other options also. It doesn't depend on the mass of the system, like temperature, pressure, etc. No, it depends. And option 3 is telling that it's not dependent on path followed but on the state. Okay, so basically if any property we are saying, then obviously it will be not dependent on the path. Okay, so it is not depending on the path followed but on the state. Okay, this can be the correct answer, but appropriate answer we have to check. And option number 4 is telling that it is dependent on the path followed and not on the state. Okay, so it doesn't depend on the path. Okay, for whichever path we may reach at the final state, but we can say your extensive property are what, that properties will be, that property change will be same. Okay, so the appropriate answer for this question will be the option number 1, that it depends on the mass of the system, like volume. So volume is an example for the extensive property. So option number 1 will be the correct answer for this question. So moving towards next question, that is question number 39. So it is asking that what is the compression ratio in case of your SI engine. Okay, so we have to say the range of the compression ratio for an SI engine. So basically the compression ratio, if you compare in between SI engine and CI engine, so it is more higher than compared to your SI engine. So in case of your CI engine will be having a higher compression ratio as compared to SI engine. So in case of your SI engine will be having a compression ratio in the range of 6 to 10. So we can take on the option number 1 as our answer, nor the your all three options which are given, 10 to 15 and 16 to 25 or 25 to 40. So so if it would ask the about CI engine, then our answer would be our, that is 60 into 25, that will be the range where compression ratio will lie for CI engine. Okay, but in case of your SI engine, it will lie in between the 6 to 10. So option 1 will be the correct answer for this question. Okay, sorry. Then moving towards the last question of this video, that is question number 40. So question is asking about boiler. So once through boiler operates at, options are given like a subcritical pressure or supercritical pressure, and option 3 is in a subcritical as well as supercritical pressures, and critical pressures only it is telling in the option number 4. So once through boiler, or it is otherwise called as your Benson's boiler. Okay, so it is a basically higher pressure boiler and water tube boiler, we can say, and draft tubeless boiler. Okay, so main thing you have to remember over here, it is a higher pressure boiler, so that's how we can say it is handling at the supercritical pressures. Okay, it can handle the supercritical pressures. Okay, so again also it can handle the subcritical pressure also. So option 3 will be the correct answer for this question, that is question number 4. Okay, so one throw boiler, so otherwise as I told you that Benson's boiler, you can remember, so it can handle subcritical as well as supercritical pressures. Okay, so it is available in the NTPC of Talcher, Odisha. So we can find this type of boilers in Odisha Talcher, that is NTPC. Okay, so option number 3 will be the correct answer for this question. So with this we reached at the end of lecture for today. So we'll be trying to discuss some more questions in the next classes, because our target is to complete 500 plus MCQs for Vizag Steel, which is going to be conducted in the following months. So if you like these videos, then press on the like button which is given below, and do share it with your friends who are preparing for different competitive exams in mechanical engineering. It will be beneficial for them also, I think so. So do share it. And final thing, if you are new here, new to this channel, then do subscribe it and press on the bell icon, so that you'll be not going to miss any updates from our channel whenever we'll be uploading any new video on this. So do subscribe it. Okay, so important thing, as already told you, do share it with your friends, so that it can give me some motivation to make some videos on this. Okay, so thank you for watching. Keep smiling and be safe. Take care of yourself. So thank you.